heard him tell the warden just before he reached my cell. Could my guitar playing friend do my request? Won't you sing me back home to the words homes I used to hear? Make my old memories come alive. Take me away. Turn back the time. Sing me back home before I die. I recall last Sunday morning when a choir from off the street came in to sing a few old gospel songs. I heard him tell Merle Haggard song, and people say, why are you singing that for? Well, there's a message in that song. There's a great message in that song, and I was telling Klein the other day, we recorded that. It's on Range Riders Making the Grade album, which was an LP, the only LP that we ever personally made, this version of the Range Riders. And anyways, long story short, it's on a CD, and it's coming back. CD's come back out. We're getting ready to remaster all that in the studio and bring a CD back. And anyways, that song we were playing one night. A friend of ours came. He came by a lot. He was a musician, but you know, he had a day job, and he worked all over the place, clear out to Yuma. And he'd swing by our house when he had a chance. His name was Jerry Barnett. He'd come by the house, and when he came by, it was jam session time, is what it was. So the piano was over here by my right, over against the wall here that time, upright piano. And we were playing that song, and I'd heard Merle, you know, I was a Merle Haggard fan, so I'd heard that song before. But when we were singing that day, I heard Rock of Ages. I heard it singing. And I said, I told Mom, I want to do it just like that. And so we did. We did in churches all over. I think the first church we ever sang it in like that was Jim and Amy Purdy's church out there in Marana on Avra Valley Road in Marana, Arizona. And we just, but you know, they were open to that. And he had to be, because the first time we went there, he played the Mississippi Gray Squirrel. So just putting that out there. So I was just thinking about that. All right, let's do that other one, that Help Me song. It's written by Larry Gatlin. And it's a great song. Of course, it changed Larry Gatlin's life, because one day Elvis heard it on a demo, Elvis Presley, and he recorded it and changed his life forever, too. And, you know, I was, and also thinking it takes people sometimes to help, even if you're talented, you're a great singer, songwriter, musician, whatever. Sometimes it takes someone else to be inspired by what you do to help you reach the next level of what you're going to do in your music. And I've seen it recently. I've seen it several times over. So you know what I'm saying is, we need each other to do these things to help us. So here's this song, "Help Me." I like it. He said he was sitting one night on the Dottie West bus, sat down on the floor with his guitar, feeling kind of like his career was going the wrong direction. things weren't happening the way he wanted it to happen. You ever felt like that? I felt like that. And he sat down on the floor and he wrote this song. Little did he know that that very song, that night when he was feeling that way, it was a prayer to God. You know, he wrote his prayer. It's what he did. Just like Kris Kristofferson wrote his prayer out when he wrote the Why Me, Lord. Yeah. So he wrote this song, and then God honored that prayer. And you got that song over in the right hands so something could happen. It's called Help Me. And you know what? It touched Elvis, too. That's why he liked it. It ministered to him. That's why he wanted to do the song. Lord, help me walk another mile, just one more mile. I'm tired of walking all alone. Oh, Lord, help me smile another smile, just one more smile. I know that I can't make it on my own. Never thought I needed help before. Thought that I could do things by myself. Now I know I just can't take it anymore. With an humble heart on bended knee, I'm begging you, please help me. Come down from your golden throne to me, to lowly me. Need to feel the touch of your tender hand. Remove the chains of darkness and let me see, dear Lord, let me see just where I fit into your master plan. Never thought I needed help before. Thought that I could do things by myself. Now I know I just can't take it anymore. With an humble heart on bended knee, I'm begging you, please help me. Yes, with an humble heart on bended knee, I'm begging you, please help me. Help me. All right, help me. I need some help. Hit me. But we'll do one more song, and then we're going to get into a little Bible study tonight. And we're trying to bring these things back. And everybody said, start your Monday night Bible study, and we'll come out and join you. Well, it's not been fantastic, the turnout, but people have been coming. But tonight we didn't expect nothing because here we are. In the midst of the aftermath of Hurricane Hillary that turned to a tropical storm. Someone said to me, what happened? What happened? Like on Dillon Road, I show in the video that I went live today when I was driving. And someone said, what happened? I said, Hurricane Hillary. And they said, I thought it was turned to a tropical storm. Yeah, that's not like tropical punch, by the way. I wanted you to know that. Or tropical perfume. It was a storm. We had horizontal rain. I mean, it was coming sideways, horizontal, straight across. And like someone was outside the house with a fire hose. That's what it felt like. And I was trying to explain to people, we're used to westerly winds from the northwest blowing across at 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 miles an hour in this pass area. So everything's battened down from that side. We don't have anything battened down from the south or southeast side. And so when the wind blew up this way, it tore everything loose because not everything. A couple things. A horse canopy blew over and some other stuff we didn't have tied down from that side. But mostly we did pretty good. The rain, I'm sure, pushed through the cracks of a lot of people's houses. I mean, because we had a few drips extra, but not major, nothing major. And normally I got some roof coating to do and things to do before winter comes. And I've been saying that I want to get past the heat of summer. We had no idea that this hurricane, this tropical fantasy we had, tropical storm, was going to blow in like this. So it was interesting. But, you know, for the most part, everything held together and we're good. And but the roads are bad. Now, Kim and I went out today to try to buy some supplies to kind of recover from the aftermath. And we left at noon and we did not get back till after 5 p.m. And we didn't get anywhere. We went 3.5 hours nowhere. Went down Dillon Road. It was blocked off from all directions. Couldn't get down across the train tracks into the lower valley to get anything. So we went to Desert Hot Springs, but they didn't really have much. We finally found a couple things to get us through. And the trucks and everybody was diverting down Dillon and all the other side roads. And it was bad. And so it was better just to stay home, but we needed a few things. But we
Interstate Dillon Road.
Oh, it was, and I-10 was eastbound, was bumper to bumper. They still hadn't gotten it cleared out. So they were doing their priorities. I-10, 62, and they called off Kim's work today. The court in Joshua Tree, they just said no one can get here, so there's no court. So they closed that down. We're not even sure about what tomorrow is going to bring because they just haven't gotten to it that fast. They'll get to it, but, you know, there's only so many of them working so fast, so they only can do what they can do. And I've seen a lot of storms in this desert, but I got to tell you, every so everybody knows what I'm talking about, on Dillon Road. Now, way out there, there's a lot of whoop-de-doos. We call them whoop-de-doos. Up and down like this. Whoop-de-doos.
They're fun.
And people love that road riding down there, Washboard Highway, because those whoop-de-doos let the water out when it rains. That's what those are for. They all run across here. And every one of those whoop-de-doos was full of debris, and some had water in it. So on our way home, we finally started making it home, and I decided to cut around some of the traffic. Thought I'd be slick. And I did pretty good till I got to 1 Street, Roberts Road, out there in front of what is that? We were there for a while. Wagner RV Park. We were there for church for a couple years. Got around there, lined up with that, and that road, Roberts Road, was a lake.
Lake Roberts.
And I told Cam, if I was just out here fooling around, I'd take a run at that water, but I don't want to get stuck, and we knew we had Bible study tonight, so we didn't do it. But we're here, and we're going to do one more song, and we're going to open our Bibles a little bit. And the devil's a liar. He's giving us hassle with this system again. And they're going to have to figure out what's going on. We're going to have to get this thing figured out. And we're going to be knocking on all the doors we can until it works for us flawlessly. And that's all there is to that. We've got to have consistency. That's all there is to it. Well, kid, Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget, no, never. And now, Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget, no, never. Well, Jesus, I'll never forget what you've done for me. I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. Jesus, I'll never forget, no, never. Praise Him, praise Him. Oh, praise Him in the morning, praise Him in the noontime. Praise Him, praise Him, praise Him when the sun goes down. Love Him, oh, love Him in the morning. you praise him, praise him. I said praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him, praise him, praise him when the sun goes down. Won't you bless that wonderful name of Jesus? Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh, now bless that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name I know. There's power in the name of Jesus. Power in the name of Jesus. Power in the name of Jesus. No other name I know. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Oh, now bless that wonderful name of Jesus. No other name I know. If my brother can't go well, I can't tear it. I'm running up the King's Highway. Well, I'm running, running, running. I can't tear it. Running, running, running. I can't tear it. Well, now running, running, running. I can't tear it. Running up the King's Highway. Well, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Well, I promised him that I would serve him till I die. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Well, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Promised him that I will serve him till I die. I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. Yes, I'm on the battlefield for my Lord. All right, Battlefield for my Lord. Got great stories about that song, too, but I'm not going to go into tonight. We get our Bibles out. Thank the musicians for their playing. I don't know if they're going to just sit here with me or what they're going to do, probably. And I'll stay here. You can, at least you can talk on your mic and help me if you need to add something.
I can do that.
If you got 2 cents worth to throw in there, let me check my email and see if they contact us on the other things. We're going to get this video. If you're not seeing it live, you're going to see it right afterwards. We're going to upload it and get up there. Something is not right. And so anyways, okay, they received my support ticket, but that's all they received. So we'll see what they say. Oh, contact us anytime. We're always here. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, that sounds like people I've known my whole life. Call me if you need me anytime. I'll be there.
Got your back.
Can you help me move? I won't be here that weekend. I didn't say what weekend it was. Whatever weekend it is, I won't be here. That's usually what that is. Yeah, there's only a few people. So I want to just read you a couple things real quick. If you got your Bibles, we're going to study a little bit tonight. And it's funny, I was singing that song, you know, about healing. It's healing in the name of Jesus, and that's where the healing is at. You know, but I'm going to talk to you about how to ignite that in your life, maybe as a believer. First of all, you got to have faith to believe. But people think, well, it's just one thing or the other. Faith is just the ability to believe what God said. Come on, isn't that true?
Yeah.
So that's what faith is. It's not a magic potion or something like that. Faith is just the ability to believe what God said. Faith in what people have faith. God gave us faith. It is something tangible in a way.
Yeah.
Because the Bible says to every man, and it means women, every person, every human being, was given the measure of faith. And so, it was measured out to us. Not that some people have more than the other, here's what I believe. I believe you can exercise your faith like you can exercise your muscles.
Yes. Faith is the evidence of things not seen.
And you stir that up. Because, you know, we saw in Jesus' time, He said to his own handpicked crew, his own disciples, he said, "How is it you have no faith?" You know, he said that to
them the whole time.
Yeah, and he picked them. You know, so don't get down on yourself if you go through moments or times like that. Because I've had times like that. You know, where I heard Charles and Francis Hunter say, "I feel like your faith went out just out your feet, just went down and went out your feet." That's how a term they use. Now, I know what that means.
Yeah.
Sometimes you need someone else to help you have faith, or at least inspire your faith. Things inspire your faith. But anyways, but Jesus also said about the centurion who said, "I have men under me." This is basically what he was saying. And all I got to do is say, "Do it," and they go do it. I don't have to go follow up on it because I know that it gets done.
Yeah.
On my word. And he told Jesus, "All you got to do is say it. You don't need to come where my daughter's at. All you got to do is say it." Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
And so
that's faith.
And Jesus looked at him and said, "I have not seen such great faith, no, not in Israel." He had that man, he had a beat on that. You know, so he understood how to appropriate that.
His own bloodline.
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, and here's the thing. Here's the thing what I'm talking about here now, healing. Faith is one thing, and that is great. You got to have faith to start with. But what puts legs under that? You know, the Bible says faith without works is dead.
Yeah.
It does say that. So we could get all these different places. I'm just trying to bring you up to a place. So I'm gonna propose something to you that I actually believe is true, and the word is compassion. The compassion to heal. We need to have the compassion that Jesus had.
Yeah.
And, I mean, we're never going to have what he had, all of that, but we need to have a little bit of that at least to see that happen. Now, we have seen, we just spoke yesterday, had Kim speak yesterday about how God healed her, and there was no special formula. There was no thing going on there. We believed that God was going to do it. We didn't know when. We pursued all the avenues we could pursue, like the woman with the issue of blood. There was no weakness in her faith that she pursued doctors. She just tried everything because she wanted to be well. How bad? I mean, some people I don't think want to be well. I'm just going to tell you the truth. I've met a lot of people who just like being sick and talking about it. And that's the truth. And I don't pull any punches about that, but that's true. There's people that just want to be sick and talk about it. And if that's you, then it doesn't do no good to pray. We can pray over you. We can smear so much oil on you, we can slide you under the door. It ain't going to work unless, you know, your faith is activated too. But when all those things align, I don't know how that all works. Someone says, "Well, why didn't God heal everybody?" I don't know what's going on in that whole situation because I'm not God.
Well, your strength needs to be tested and strengthened. God could heal everybody. He could bring it all back to.
He certainly could. Yeah, certainly able.
He could breathe it all back into like it was at the beginning if he wanted to.
You know, but as far as individuals, people need to understand that there's a lot of moving parts with other people.
Sure.
Why do you think Jesus said to the blind man or the blind men, depending what story you're going to, what would you have God do for you? Basically, you know. What do you want? You'd think it'd be readily obvious, but you know it's not readily obvious. He could have said, "Well, I have a splinter under my fingernail. come. You know what I'm saying?
I've been blind all my life. Yeah. So just fix the history.
Some people, true.
They get the finger, the splinter. I don't worry about the eyesight.
They accept sometimes the predicament they're in. So you can't. It's hard to get past that if they're accepting that as the normal for their life. Now, for Kim, you know, she was praying. She, of course, being without her voice wasn't normal. And, yeah, I was there in the doctor's office when they put the scope down her nose three times.
Ooh.
Three different times.
Well, they went down her nose.
Yeah, down her nose. And he said, we can see there's no anomalies.
That's
there's no bad. Tumors. There's nothing that we would that we can associate with. They wanted to do another place. Wanted to do a full scan. But the one doctor was, that's all he does is throats. He said, there's nothing there. All we can see is they're trying to work, but they're not working. Your vocal cords are trying to work, but they're not working. So he said, basically, it's like your brain is not sending the signal to your vocal cords. Isn't that weird? So, you know, I'm going to throw something else out there in the way that so you can deal with it. When the doctors have tried to find the problem and you still got it, it may be more of a spiritual thing going on than a physical thing.
Yeah, there's a battle.
Satan has got something going.
Yeah,
and you say, well, how can you do that? I'm a believer. Listen, he certainly can do it. And so we'll get into that. I guess Rosanna's going to throw in something here because I heard the mic come live. Okay, go ahead.
Well, when... Can you be down a little bit?
Yeah, a little loud.
Yeah, a lot.
Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know.
That's good. What do you got?
When I had the strokes, I went to see the neurologist. He said, you shouldn't be talking plain. You shouldn't be walking. You had that bad of a stroke. And Comas told him, she said, we've been praying. And he said, in other words, he left the impression it must have worked to keep it up. Because I know that's what brought me out of it.
Whatever you're doing, keep doing it.
I believe it with all my heart. Yeah. And it's true. He looked at the chart and said, well, you had two cranial bleeds. Blood clot and a cranial bleed, and went on down the list. And he said, you know, in other words, the paralysis should have been a lot more than that.
Yeah.
But, you know, God used that. Now, let me point out Rosa's situation. She came in here one day. She said something was wrong, and her words were all garbled. Not totally garbled, but just garbled enough we knew something was wrong.
I was saying things
wrong.
Wrong.
And we said, she wanted a banana clip, and she said banana split. Her brain wasn't connecting it right. And just different things. And so we almost asked, we talked about it, and we prayed for it immediately. Of course, we did that first.
Yes.
And then we did that first. And then we said, well, let's call 911 and get help. Because, you know, that's the smart thing to do. I'm going to just talk to you about dumbness. Like, I talk about dumbness in the body of Christ. That's the people that says, well, you know, my child is diabetic, and so we're just going to pray over and believe God for him, and we're not going to take him to the doctors or anything else, and then the kid dies. That's happened. We've seen it on the thing. And, if you have faith enough to believe God's going to heal your child, he can heal him in the hospital.
That's right.
I'm just seeing that happen. But, you know, God uses all sorts. And doctors, there's nothing wrong with doctors. Now, there is something wrong with, you know, with how this comes about and the pharmaceutical companies and all that. You know, we can get into that and really peel back the onion on that, but I'm not doing that. But I'm saying individual people. There are a lot of doctors that are just doctors because they want to make a lot of money.
Yeah.
But there are some doctors that just are there because they feel it's their calling in life. We've met some of those doctors. And Luke was a doctor in the Bible. And it doesn't say that, but it says he was, you know, probably was drawn to Jesus because of what he saw him do. If you were a doctor in those kind of primitive times, you know, and you saw great miracles happening in Jesus, and that would probably draw you in pretty good.
Yeah, quite a bit.
So, you know, so anyways, quickly with Rose now, she had the stroke, and she went to the hospital. Then they gave her some medication to straighten her out with the AFib in her heart. But then she had some bleeding. And we thought, well, it's probably because they've been giving her too many blood thinners. That's what we were thinking. But you see, God used that. Not that God put it upon her, but God used that stroke in that part of it to address the main problem, which was cancer. We would have never known about it till it was probably too late.
Yeah.
You know, and God used all that and brought the right people in their path instantaneously. So, you know, you can't say that wasn't God moving. And God does, it does use people. Help me believe that. He uses individuals. And he'll use a doctor. Listen, he can even use a lawyer. He's done it. Don't shout me down when I'm preaching good. He can use a lawyer. So the compassion of Christ to heal, that's what, it's not a special gift that you just, oh, I've got the gift to heal. You know, yeah, I can, God will maybe pour out on somebody an anointing for a specific time or thing. But, you know, I believe that's for every believer. That's why the Bible says, desire ye the best gifts. What does that mean? One gift is better than the other one? No. What is not being performed in the body you're in? If you're attending a church or you're in a group of people, and what spiritual application is not being applied, that's the one I should want.
Yes.
I shouldn't want your job. You shouldn't want my job if I got one.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But it needs to be a balance.
Yeah, but you shouldn't want the thing that's not being done.
Yeah.
And so that's to me, that's the best gift. So I want to read you a little bit of Psalms. Let me see where I want to read from. I want to read Psalms, part of Psalms 103. And I want to read you a couple other scriptures. Because the Psalm says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases." Come on, somebody ought to say a great big amen. He can do these things. And you say, how can, I don't believe somebody can, how can, it's a horrible disease. How can they be healed of that?
What is the benefit of God?
Well,
the benefits of, you know, what's?
If he's just benign and off to the right somewhere and nothing's happening, I don't, I told somebody one time, I said, we're talking about old biblical miracles, you know, like the pillar of fire by night and the cloud by day, and they found all the great things and the Red Sea parting and then the altar being consumed by fire, all those great miracles. Yeah. I love those. Samson, how he prayed and God poured power in his body, and he actually plowed through the gates of the city at one point and carried those big, huge, giant gates and threw them in a heap over there. I mean, I believe all those stories. And I told somebody, they said, well, none of that stuff, you know, it's not today. I said, well, we'd be better off in the Old Testament. We saw more. If it doesn't happen today, if God isn't the same, which the Bible declares that he is, if it doesn't happen today, then we should go back to Old Testament times, what I told him. Oh, no, we're in the dispensation of grace. I said, you're missing my point. If we can't see the hand of God move upon his people like he did in those days, then we're being shortchanged.
Yeah.
But I read in the Bible where in Malachi it says, I am God and I change not. I read in the New Testament which says, Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. And what he did back then, he'll do today. And what you read in the pages of the Bible, even about Jesus, he'll still do today. Now, that's the part that people trip over. And, I don't think I can believe that. Well, as long as you keep thinking like that.
How many times have you heard the story of, say, a car roll over and some little mother picking up the whole car off the child or something like that? Or we've all seen the dead come up out of the hospital bed. You know, yesterday, today, and forever. You know, changes not.
And not only does it say that, that doesn't blow your mind enough. It says, greater work shall you do. Jesus said that.
Yes.
And the reason I know Jesus said it, because it's written in red in my Bible. Jesus said, greater work shall you do, because I go unto the Father. Now think about that for a minute.
Yeah.
I just think we're limiting God. And, you know, I think a lot of people say, well, it doesn't happen anymore because they haven't seen it. Well, just because it hasn't happened in your life, or in your sphere of influence, doesn't mean it's still not there.
Well, the healing that we've seen in our personal lives, I mean, you, when you got your legs burned really, really bad, he's got no scars, or you know, the cancer and the strokes that Rosanelle has gone through, the loss of voice, and the multitude of things that we've all personally encountered, or people that we personally know that have had these encounters.
Well, I've told the story, and we got to move on, but I'll tell the story real fast if I can. And I was thinking about, first of all, if you want to read a book that'll inspire you to life, it's a book about a man named Smith Wigglesworth.
Oh, yeah.
Ever Increasing Faith. Look this book up, order it from Amazon or someplace else. Get this book in your hands. Ever Increasing Faith is not, he didn't write a book. He never wrote a book in his life. Every book about that man was written about him.
About him.
Think about that for a minute. Man, they have documented cases, which is what put him on the map in the first place, of where he would lay. They went to pray for a guy, and he was dead when they got there. And he was very unorthodox. So he pulled that dead man's body out of the bed and began to pray life back into him. And I tell you, if you were with him, if I was with him, and he didn't like the way our spirit was lining up with him, he'd make us leave.
Out the door.
He'd be gone because he was determined. And you know what? He got results. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
He got results. So I never gone that far, but I will tell you the story that I'll tell you. I was down at some years ago, back in the 90s. I was associate pastor at the Calvary Southern Baptist Church. Amidst a lot of stuff going on there, but God had me there for a reason, and he was doing a great work there. So I never was Southern Baptist. I don't have a problem with Baptists. I say God bless the Baptists. You know, but I never was Baptist, but I was invited in to do this, so I was there. So anyways, while I was doing that, pastor down there said, we're having the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, just the day before, we're having the all interdenominational, the Association of Pastors coming together for their Thanksgiving service, and they're coming to this church. He said, I want you to preach that sermon. Which I thought was a great honor. So I said, okay, I'm looking forward to that. So I go down to the store on Tuesday, and I'm downtown Tuesday, and the woman, a neighbor, lived right across the way from us. And if they were still there, they lived directly between David and Donna's house and us. So that's where they're right, would have been right there. And but anyways, they're not no longer there now. But she walked up to me. She was not a believer. In fact, she was very much against Christianity. She tried many times to come here and to rock the boat, you know, but she had never met anyone like her mom, who just dealt with her flawlessly, you know. So anyway, long story short, she came up to me and said her son Tom had been around us a lot. He'd sneak off and come to Bible study because she didn't care for him doing that, and even though he was a grown man, but he lived there with her, and so she knew that we hung out a little bit together, and David never once. He was kind of a nerdy, smart guy, you know. And she walked up to me in the line at Stater Brothers, the market, and said, this is what she said, Tom's dead. I said, what? I hadn't heard a thing, you know. Huh. And she went on to tell me he was dead, and the funeral is Friday, like Friday week, not the next Friday, but the Friday week. And so I said, okay, she said, and it's at Rose Mortuary. She told me that. So I went up to Rose Mortuary, which is in town, and I went to talk to Tom Moen, who was there. I think he's still there. And I went and talked to him. I said, so what's the deal? I said, I didn't have no idea that he was even having any problems. And he said, oh, yeah. And he went on to explain a little bit. He said, she did tell you that she wanted you to do the funeral, right? I said, no, she failed to mention that part of it. I just felt like I needed to go talk to him, and I had no idea. Oh, yeah, she wants you to do the funeral. So I said, okay. He said, but the weird part is I went down to claim the body at the hospital, and they said I couldn't have him because he was still hooked up to machines because they're keeping him alive to harvest his organs. I said, what? I said, we can't. I don't know. I said, we're going to have a funeral over a live body? And Tom said, well, I guess he's technically brain dead, so that's what we're going to have to do. But I said to Tom, where there's life, there's hope. Because sometimes you got to encourage yourself in the Lord.
Yeah.
I'm not saying Tom was being discouraging. He was just looking at the facts. The facts were they said he was dead. And the facts were they just cut him off. And they were going to take his organs out and let him die. So anyways, I go out to the car and I sit down. I'm telling this too long, but I sit down in the car. And I'm in the car, and I'm overwhelmed with all this thinking. I've got to preach this sermon on Wednesday, and it's tomorrow, and Thanksgiving, and all this is going on. And all of a sudden, what are we going to do about this? And I'm sitting there, And I'm sitting there in the car all by myself, and I hear this voice say, "I am the resurrection and the life." And, you know, I heard it like I'd never heard it before. And I don't mean to make fun of people. I've heard a lot of preachers quote that at funerals. I've heard that kind of a weak, anemic, droll, "I am the resurrection and the life." Because you're not getting it. We're not getting it. Jesus was there with Mary and Martha, and Lazarus had died. And he said, "Do you believe he'll live again?" And she said, "I believe he'll live again in the resurrection." We're always looking down the road at something. And he looked at her and said, "Look at me. I am the resurrection.
Yes.
I am the life. Not someday. Not down the road.
Right
I'm
now.
Standing right before you. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live." Somebody ought to say amen.
Yeah.
And so when I heard that, it felt so good. I heard it again a second time. And then the third time, I just said it out loud. And I tell you what, I felt the Holy Spirit rain down in that car. And I wanted to go pray for him. And I had started to go, but then all of a sudden I realized I don't even know where he is. So I go home and tell them the story, and I go down to the Wednesday service, thinking I got all this on my mind. And before the service started, I get a phone call, and the phone call was from my mom, who said that Mary Eaton had called, and that Tom was. She said we postponed the funeral because they'd seen something in his heart, like the heart rate or something. But they still had do not resuscitate signs on him.
Uh-huh.
So that bought us some time, you see. So in a couple of days or so, I don't know how long it was, after that, preached that sermon. It was a great night. And so Jim Graham and I decided we'd go down and find Tom and pray for him. So Jim Graham and I went down to the hospital, found out where he was. I think Jim found out where he was. And we went down, and he was in the subacute ward at Desert Hospital. We walked in that room, and he was in there with tubes sticking out of him from all directions. I tell you what, people go through that, and they see that. It's easy for your faith just to go out your feet, just be gone. And so that's why you need people with you.
Yeah.
You know, you need to go in sometimes teamed up. So I looked at Jim, and he looked over at me, and we didn't know what to think. So I said, "Let's just go ahead and pray for him." So Jim, he ripped out this bottle of anointing oil. And Jim, you'd have to appreciate this more if I kind of describe it to you. Jim had a rough life at the beginning. He was a drug addict and all kinds of stuff. And he should have been dead 1,000 times over. God preserved him. But he still had, you know, he was clean, but he still had the remnants of that effect on him, you know. So he was kind of like, you know, so he got, I'm probably going to get sued for telling this story. So anyways, he got that bottle out, and he was nervous, you know. And when he was nervous, he screwed the lid off. When he went over the top of Tom's head, instead of just putting a little bit on his head, he went, it just dumped the whole thing all over his head, the whole bottle.
The whole bottle.
So what are we going to do? So anyways, we laid hands on him and started praying, and God is my witness. The minute we started praying over him, every machine in that room went nuts. And even his eyelids started moving, you know, and the numbers started going everywhere. Now, he didn't just open up his eyes right then. Because, see, God's got a plan. And it wasn't about me and Jim. God just used us. We were just a vessel that he took down there to use for that particular time. But there was other people watching, other denominations. One of the other churches, I won't go into which church it was, and he was always getting upset about something. If he saw a teensy-weensy bit of God move somewhere, this pastor, he would throw a fit about it. When we were having prayer for revival, he said, we come into the meeting the next week, I thought we were praying for revival, not actually having revival. So I was thinking, we're praying for something we're not actually going to have?
That's how that works.
I was thinking, the end result should be
a revival.
So the same guy. So anyways, his church, he was one told me that when we sang one time, the Range Riders sang at one of the events, prayer for revival events, that his people were frightened them. They didn't know what that was. I was thinking, they weren't frightened. They were back to having a good time. I'm a great read of a room. I'll tell you right now, I'm not bragging on myself, but I've been behind a microphone a long time in my life.
Fear of God.
I'm looking back there. People are having a good time. Only one was afraid probably was him.
Yeah.
You know, so this was going on. So this particular nurse that was down there actually attended his church.
Hmm.
So there was a lot of that going on down there. So anyways, this one little black nurse went in there, whatever she was. She went in there, and she saw the signs, defied the signs that said, do not resuscitate. That means in any shape or form.
Yeah.
And she opened up his eyes with her fingers and said, Mr. Eden, I know you're in there. Wake up. And he woke up. Come on, somebody say amen. And he woke up. He lived many years after, 15 years or so after that. And so, you know, that's an experience that we had. He was dead. He was clinically dead. They said his brain was mush. So don't give up even when they say give up. Just hold on to what God says. And I've seen some other stuff too. So you get something else you're going to throw in there? No, you just. Okay. All right. So I'm going to read on the scripture real quick. I got kind of off left field there a little bit. But Amy was the compassion for healing. Faith is great, but compassion will cause things to happen. I'm going to show you that in a minute. Let me read on. Who redeemeth our life from destruction, verse 4 says, who crowneth thee with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies thy mouth with good things, so that thy youth is renewed like the eagle. The Lord executeth righteousness and the judgment for all that are oppressed. He made known his ways unto Moses, his acts unto the children of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and plenteous in mercy. Can somebody say amen? And on and on and on, you need to read the Psalms 103. But I'm going to pop over here to the New Testament real quick because I was kind of taking a long time here. And I'm talking about the, the compassion of Jesus Christ. What and how we possess that. Now, when he anointed the disciples, I don't want to get too into that because it'll throw things off a little bit. But see, the Holy Spirit was in operation, obviously.
Yeah.
Because we know that John the Baptist was filled with the Spirit from his mother's womb. The Bible declares that. But there was a greater operation after Jesus was crucified and resurrected and ascended unto the Father. He said, I will send you the Helper. Tarry until you're endued with power from on high. And on the 50 days after that Passover, when Jesus was crucified, 50 days later was the day of Pentecost. In the upper room, where they were in one accord, and the tongues of fire fell upon each one, they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance, and they were empowered. That was the empowering. So we get hung up on the tongues, and we forget what the other part's for. Yeah. But Jesus explained it. He said, the Holy Spirit that is alongside you shall be in you. So there was a deepening of that. I don't think you can really get saved without the Holy Ghost. That's what I'm going to just tell you right now. You're never going to get led to the foot of the cross by a denomination or just somebody saying a sinner's prayer. That is why, listen to me, I'm not. Besides the fact that there's so much wrong with it, the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witnesses, they are just pushy, knocking on doors. Why is it they don't get very many takers with that? Because the Holy Ghost is not in it.
Yes.
They're just trying it at their own speed and own power. And if you try it by your own power, you're going to fail and wonder why you failed. You're failing because the Bible says the footsteps of a righteous man are ordered of the Lord. You go where God tells you to go, and bang, 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 things really happen. You don't think Peter and John just happened down to the temple to pray on their own volition after they received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They were going down there to pray, but God had an appointment for them. Am I chasing too many things right now? Because I just feel like I need to talk about this. They walked down there, and at the gate called Beautiful, there was a guy begging alms. He'd been down there for his whole life, basically. And he was born crippled. And they carried him down there because there was no program, no welfare or Social Security programs, anything else for them to make a way for their life, like we have programs here in this country for that now. But he had to do something. So he had to beg to bring in his portion of his keep, you might say. So he was there all the time, and people got used to seeing him. You get a good spot, you keep it. How many know that?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Even these erroneous beggars, we know that aren't nothing wrong with them. Sometimes they got their fancy car hidden down there behind a tree. I see them, and they're out there with a sign. I just want to smack them sometimes.
They're making more money than you and I.
Oh, I saw one woman down there with her children. I thought, shame on you.
Yeah.
Shame on you, even if it's real. Even if this is real, shame on you for embarrassing your kids like that. That's not right. But that's a whole other story. But this man here was clearly in need. And I remember in our lifetime, before they had programs, when we'd see guys on carts and they'd walk with their hands,
yeah.
You know, roll themselves along with their hands. And there wasn't a lot of outlet for people, but we didn't have handicap parking or sidewalks or anything else. There was nothing prepared for nobody at that time. So, you know, so we've seen a lot of change in our lifetime. But imagine going back that many years, 2,000 years ago, and how there was nothing. So this man was there at the gate called Beautiful because people passed by, they saw him, they felt sorry for him. Maybe sometimes they felt a little guilty and they gave him money. And so he that day, they happened by there, but they walked by this time in a whole different light. They were endued with the power from on high. The Holy Ghost was thriving in them, and there was an appointment. They didn't, none of them knew that, but this man had an appointment. This was their appointment right here. And so Peter said, look on us. And he looked on them, the Bible says, expecting to receive something from them. Now, he didn't know what he was going to receive. He could have been a quarter or whatever their equivalent of that is. You know what I'm saying? Or a buck or whatever he might do. That's what he was thinking. But see, God supersedes your expectations. And so he said, look on us. And they looked on him, and then he said something. It could have flattened all of his tires if he wasn't really desiring, but he said, silver and gold have I none. Uh-oh, well, he's not going to give me a buck then.
Yeah,
he
ain't
got no, he's got no money, so that ain't happening. But such as I have, give I thee. And he said, in the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Kaplowy, something happened. And you know what happened? Faith in action.
Yes.
They walked over. Full of the compassion of Jesus, they walked over and they picked that man up, one on the right, one on the left. They stood him up, and the Bible says instantly his limbs had strengthened him. And he went walking and leaping and praising God. Can somebody say amen? Yeah. And so that is the power of that happening. So they had that appointment. So over here in Matthew, if you want to take time to find that, I just lost my other place, but I think I can find it. Matthew chapter 14, I think it's verse 14. It says this, and Jesus went forth, Matthew 14:14, and Jesus went forth and saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion toward them, and he healed their sick. What happened to Jesus? He was moved with compassion. Compassion will move you. And I tell people all the time, compassion will move you. Now, pity is powerless. You can pity and feel sorry for somebody all day long, but there's no strength in that.
No.
But compassion will move you. Come on, somebody say amen. So I think it's over here at 15:33. We're just going to turn the page and go a little bit further over. And I'm going to close with this here. Let me back up a bit. Where do I want to start this from? See where I want to start. There's so many good stuff here. I don't want to leave them out. Now this above this where I'm going to read is where the Syrophoenician woman came, and this is before, of course. I'm in chapter 15. I'm not going to read it all. But if you start, Matthew 15, about the. I can start here, verse 21. It says, and Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a woman of Canaan came out of the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. But Jesus answered her not a word. And his disciples came and besought him, saying, send her away, for she crieth after us. Now, I always thought this was pretty interesting because Jesus was setting them all up for one great big lesson, which he often does with us, even us. So he didn't talk to her, and he waited for the disciples. They said, send her away. Send her away from the very job that you've called us to do. The Bible says, be instant in season, out of season. And this is where compassion comes in really handy. Because sometimes you got to call on something beyond yourself.
Yeah.
Sometimes you got to see, even if you're feeling, which I have a little story about that too, but if you're feeling like you've been wronged or something in the process, you have to see beyond yourself and what you're going through to have compassion for somebody else.
Yeah.
And that's what will move you in faith for these things. So they said to send her away, you know, because she crieth after us. And verse 24 says, but he answered and said, I am not sent. He's answering her now. I am not sent, but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Then came she and worshipped him, saying, Lord, help me. But he answered and said, it is not meet to give, to take the children's bread and to cast it to the dogs. And so, you know, he was trying to shut her down. And the disciples were watching. And she said, that's true. Truth, Lord. Yet the dogs eat the crumbs which fall from their master's table. Come on, somebody say amen.
Yeah,
she recognized him as the master. She didn't care what had to happen next. She didn't have to have a loaf of bread or eat a full meal. She said, I'm happy with the crumbs because I know the crumbs are going to do it. Come on, somebody say amen.
The crumbs are still from the master's table.
Absolutely. Jesus said, if I heal with the finger of God, the finger of God. That's what he said. Doesn't take much because it's God.
It's God.
That's what I'm saying. So she said, but still they eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Then Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith. Be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. Now, it doesn't say it right there, but right there it says, that shows all of a sudden that compassion wells up in you. It welled up in Jesus, and he couldn't help himself. He couldn't help but do what he does. And be who he is, which is exactly why he didn't go straight to Lazarus when he was sick. Because the nature of God is to heal.
There was a bigger picture that needed to be painted.
Well, you know, and the first way he identified himself, even to the Hebrew children, was, I am the God that healeth thee. That's what he said.
Yeah.
So, I mean, one of the first ways. So, that's who he is. So, let me finish it real quick. Then, Jesus answered and said, her woman, great is thy faith, be it unto thee even as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole from that very hour. And Jesus departed from thence and came nigh unto the Sea of Galilee and went up into a mountain and sat down there. Now listen close. He sat down there because he knew that this mortal body needed a rest from all the stuff that was going on. You remember when the woman with the issue of blood touched the hem of his garment. He said, someone touched me. And they said, who touched you? Everybody's touching you. But he let them know, no, someone touched me in faith believing.
Yeah.
And he said, I felt virtue pass from my body. So, you know, this takes a toll on the human body. You got to have some rest. So Jesus went up the mountain to rest. And so he sat down there. And a great multitude came unto him, having with them those that were lame, blind, dumb, maimed, and many others, cast them down at Jesus' feet. And he healed them, insomuch that the multitude wondered when they saw the dumb to speak, and the maimed to be made whole, the lame to walk, and the blind to see. And they glorified the God of Israel. Then Jesus called his disciples unto him and said, I have compassion on the multitude because they continue with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I will not send them away fasting, lest they faint in the way. And his disciples said unto him, whence should we have so much bread in the wilderness as to fill so great a multitude? And Jesus said unto them, how many loaves have ye? And they said, 7 and a few fish. And he commanded the multitude to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and the fish and gave thanks and brake them and gave them to his disciples and the disciples to the multitude. And they did all eat and were filled, and they took up the broken meat that was left, 7 baskets full. And they that did eat were 4,000 men besides women and children. And they and he sent them sent away the multitude and took ship and came into the coast of Magdala. Now, here's the deal. He said, I had compassion on the multitude. See, every time you see Jesus have compassion, it's there's action with it. It's not so, I feel sorry for them, but they're going to have to go away hungry. That's all there is to that. So what I'm trying to give you tonight is that's the thing we need to pray for when not that I might, my light shines. It's not my light. I'm not doing nothing. If a gnat had a headache, I couldn't do nothing for it in myself. I just couldn't do it. I have no power to do that. But I've watched the power of God do many great things, and I love to be in that place. I love to be in the fray of when the Holy Spirit's moving and doing those things. But the compassion of Jesus, when that really wells up inside of you, it will take action. It is not, it will never stay in neutral. It will not back up. It will cause things to happen, the compassion of Jesus. And I believe Smith Wigglesworth, who I talked about earlier, was full of compassion. And he did very odd things sometimes, but with results.
Yes.
And so how many know God said he'd take the foolish to confound the wise? And on and on and on, we could talk about the Bible like that. But I wanted to focus you on this one particular thing, the compassion of Jesus. When you begin to feel, it's beyond feeling sorry. You can get people to feel sorry for you until the cows come home. They can do nothing for you. You can go down to the corner bar and tell them your woes, and everybody there is going to feel sorry for you. And they might even buy you something to drink that you don't even need. But my point is, they can't do anything for you. They're as lost as you are and undone and powerless. It takes somebody with faith that's pushed by the compassion of Jesus Christ to get things done. And God's raising those people up. And someone said to me, talked to me about what I think the end time revival is going to be and where we're at with all this. And I think we're starting to see little pieces of it, nudges of it all over.
Yeah.
But I said, what the Lord revealed to me a long time ago, and I stand on this, he said, it will not be from the pulpit. It'll be from the pew. What does that mean? That means the people. The people.
Yeah.
They're the ones. It's going to be the people. And, you know, that's really what propagated that great movement coming out of the 60s into the 70s. The people. They were hungry, and sometimes there's people wandering around hungry looking for something to tell them, what does this mean? What does this mean? I found this book, and I've been trying to read it. What does it mean? That's why God sends teachers. Well, that's what we need a teacher for,
yeah.
You know, just to help us get our footing and understand, which is, I'm kind of like, I'm
like the first stepping stone when you're stepping on a path.
Pre-teaching is what I'm doing tonight. Preaching and teaching. So I forget what I'm doing. But my point is, that's why we gather together in the church. That's why the pastor presents a sermon. It better have pertinence. It better get you on down the road where you're going, because I'm telling you, that's what it's for. And so tonight I'm talking to you about this compassion of Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
So I hope you got something out of that. I don't know how long I went, probably too long. But anyways, so let's bow our heads and let's pray. And if you're watching this tonight and or tomorrow or whenever you're watching it someday, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, that's number one. You need to do that first. And that's not some magic bullet. That's not something that you pull out of left field. That is saying, I believe Jesus is the Son of God. I believe he died for my sins. I believe he rose again the third day, and I'm putting all my trust in him. He's alive, and he's willing to touch our lives.
Yeah.
And minister to us. And if you receive that, that's what the Bible says. Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart that Jesus Christ rose from the dead. That's who he is. And it's that if you receive that, that's what you do. Now, how do you do that? You got to receive him. And there's no special prayer. And we say a prayer because we think it helps people get to that place. But I've seen circumstances, I won't go into the details now, where I've watched how the Lord himself has led that person to the throne of grace, and they gave their heart to Jesus Christ and didn't believe before, but now they believe. I was asked one old guy when he was on his deathbed in his 90s, who had been an atheist his entire life, and he said he had a dream, one that talked to me about it. I went down there thinking I was going to find a scared old man afraid to die, but I found a man who met Jesus. He met Jesus, and they talked it out, sorted it out. And I asked him, and I said, if you die tonight, you say you're going to die. If you die tonight, where do you think you're going to go? Listen, there's an assurance in knowing Christ. You don't have to say, oh, I hope I'm going to go to heaven. I don't know. Listen, there's an assurance in knowing Jesus. I asked this old man who never walked with the Lord one day of his life, who fought with his family over the fact that he didn't believe there was a God, and all these things, and thought that people who believed in God were weak and weak-minded and needed something to lean on. But one night, 2 days before this man died, Jesus appeared before him, and they sorted out his life, a lot like Paul or Saul on the Damascus Road. They sorted it out. And so I asked him, I said, where do you think you're going to go if you die tonight? Well, I didn't pray the sinner's prayer with that man. You know, that's what people, and people say, sometimes when I say I hear gasps. No, salvation is this. Believe in your heart. Confess with your mouth.
And he did that.
He told me, he said, I've been such a fool. And he went on and on. And tears ran down his face prior to that, telling me things. And I asked him, I said, finally, I said, where do you think you're going to go? Where are you going to go if you die tonight? And I'll tell you what, he was not a man afraid to die. He was a man with assurance. A big smile came on his face. There was like a glow on that man. A big smile came on his face. He said, I believe I'm going to heaven. I said, I believe you are too. Come on, somebody say amen. Yeah. We just had a nice shouting fest right there. And I thought, he didn't seem like a guy who was dying. But 2 days later, he went to see Jesus. And I tell you what, that old song said, the old account was settled long ago. And I tell you what, you pray for those people. You hold them up before Jesus, no matter how bad they get. Because God's got a plan. You can't force them into heaven, but they're going to have a chance to make a decision. And you pray God softens their heart enough that they'll receive it. And so no one else would say, his own family wouldn't say any more to him. Because he was so adamant about it. They fought about it. They had such arguments about it. That when I mentioned that dream in the room, his two daughters and his two son-in-laws, which were older people, ran out of that room. They didn't want no part of it. But when I left that room, I said, thank you, God, for letting me see this. I didn't have to be here, but you let me be here because I got to see that and see what, that's real salvation right there. Not just saying some few words, but it helps you. If it helps you, it helps you. Maybe you don't know what to say. I just think if people don't have to know what to pray, they can pray it. He had a conversation with Jesus, which is prayer, by the way. Come on.
Yeah.
That's what praying is. So he had that conversation. So let's have a conversation with Jesus right now. Say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash me and make me clean. I want to live for you. You're the one that I want to live for. I thank you for dying for me and paying a price I could not pay. And I want to follow you, and I want us to be friends. In Jesus' name I pray it. Amen. If you pray a prayer like that, mean it. That's all you need. Just mean that. Talk with God. Tell him what your problems are. Tell him your hang-ups. He already knows where your hang-ups. He already knows where you're messed up at. So be honest with him. He wants to help you with him. That's who he is. Now, for believers, I want to encourage you to keep on believing and stir up that faith and stir up those gifts that are within you and let the compassion of Jesus rise up out of your insides. And that is the word for tonight. God bless you. We love you. Remember to do what I always say when you step out tomorrow. And, boy, we've been stepping out this stinking flood going on. We'll be happy to smile at people tomorrow. They see us with a smile on our face tomorrow, they're going to think something's wrong with us. For sure, we're going to smile real big. And when they say, why are you smiling? We're going to say, I've been to church, I've been to Bible study, and I always feel better when I do that. God bless you. We love you. And we'll see you next time.